see you all here today. So I wanted to start by acknowledging that, you know, Valentine's Day is on Tuesday, right? And that's just a couple of days from now. And it really, honestly, wasn't in my consciousness until I started to think about this last week, that here we are at this momentous place of marriage, right? Between our two organizations, the International and the United. And it's happening when? Valentine's Day. And what do we say in this teaching? That there are only two real, whoopsie, sorry, won't go over there. There are only two real emotions, right? There is fear and there is love. And my guess, and I'm going to explore this a little bit further, is that this journey that the two centers have been on has covered both of those feelings as we've been through it. So I don't think it's any accident that this is happening on Valentine's Day. I think it's absolutely perfect. So when we think about an organization like the Center for Spiritual Living, it's very interesting to my mind, because I'm sort of that investigative type, to look at the entomology of what exactly that word means. And I pulled it out, and I don't want to make a mistake. I'm hoping this is off, because I want to make sure that you hear it exactly the way it is. So entomology of the word organization is that with which one works. How many times in this teaching do we hear about the way it works? And here we've got an organization. And what do we talk about? The way it works. And then when we're trying to do work for ourselves, we talk about how do things work. So it's a constant thread, and I don't think, as I say, that it's any accident. Not that long ago, I had a very interesting experience with a friend of mine, and I see her pretty regularly and gotten to know her a lot better over the years. And she comes to the Gratitude Cafe quite regularly, and some of you may know who I'm talking about. And yes, I did get permission to share this story, but I'm not going to name names. And she came one day, and she had, let's say, a less than, she had a condition. We'll say it was a condition, right? And I thought it was maybe a cold sore. So I didn't want to say anything, because it's like, you know, people have things, and I always want to see the perfection in absolutely everything. So I didn't mention anything about it. She didn't mention anything about it, until suddenly she said, you know, I had an accident. And I said, really? And she said, yeah, I did. Look at this, look at this. And so I looked at it, and what had happened was she had actually fallen out of a bed. She was in a bunk bed and taking care of her grandson, and I guess she got the top bunk, right? The grandson got the bottom bunk. I don't know how it worked. But anyway, she was in an unfamiliar situation. And she fell out of the bed and she split part of her lip. So what I thought was just a cold sore was actually something that required stitches. So over a course of a number of weeks, she and I would talk, and you know, I would see it healing, right? I wouldn't see her. I'd see her on Sunday, then I'd see her again on Wednesday, see her on Sunday, see her on Wednesday. Sometimes I might, you know, might miss a week or something. I was astounded at how fast it was healing. And she would share with me that, you know what's really weird? She said, I got the stitches out and they said everything's fine. You can see how perfect it is here, but on the inside, it's still so sensitive. And that really got me thinking, because I'm seeing perfect, whole, and complete, and she's seeing, you know, it's still so sensitive. She said, the weirdest thing, before this happened, I never even paid attention to this part of my body. I never thought about it. I never recognized it. I didn't even know it was there. And now, all I can do is think about this tiny little part, right? And I thought, isn't that interesting? Because at that point, I was going through my own healing experience, and I was noticing that I was super sensitive. And sometimes I would even say, I try to avoid the phrase oversensitive, because that was a label that got added to me when I was quite young. You're oversensitive, right? And so I started to think, okay, so where's the common ground here? Here's our body, right? But we also have our mind. We also have that internal working that's happening. And where is the connection? And I think there is one. I know there is one, and you know there is one, because we know that it's all one whole. So what lessons can we learn from this experience? So I started to think about, I've got a body, and I'm oversensitive. What's happening with my friend's body when it's oversensitive? It's healing. It's healing. So when we are going through these periods where we react to stuff, and we know that we're getting triggered, and we're seeing things happening, my guess is that we are in a process of healing. If we keep picking at that wound, grabbing at it, scratching it off, what's going to happen? We're going to slow down the healing, right? That's what happens with the body, that's what happens with the mind, that's what happens with our spirit. So one of the things that we use in this teaching, obviously, is we use spiritual mind treatment. And what that does is it unifies us to remind us of the wholeness that we already are. So I want to go back a bit to what we were talking about in the beginning with the two centers for spiritual living. So around the 1950s, which was, let's see, Ernest Holmes wrote his textbook, the one that we use, The Science of Mind, in around 1926, 28, somewhere in that neighborhood. And so this was the 1950s. So the book and the teaching has been around for, you know, a fair number of decades. I mean, the grand scheme of spiritual teaching is barely a blink, right? But within our teaching, decent amount of time, and a rift evolved. And it was irreconcilable rift. So much so that it split the two organizations apart. And if you go into the background of it, it was, you could argue whether it was a necessary rift or whatever, but it was obviously really difficult for the people that were involved. So much so that they didn't speak to one another, and you know, the idea for many, many decades was never the twain shall meet again. My guess, and it's not even a guess, it's true, is there was a lot of healing work that took place. There was that wound period. Then there was that separation period where each of the two bodies were able to return to themselves, think about, okay, who am I? Who am I really? Am I perfect, whole, and complete as myself? Or do I need to be something different, something other than who I am? And the more clear they became about who they were, the more ability they had to be able to extend outward and allow that opportunity for healing to take place. It didn't have to take place. It's a choice, right? It's always a choice. But there was that opportunity and that willingness. They stopped speaking for a period of time so that they could get that healing to occur. And then, you know, thanks to Dr. Ken, in big part, they started to come together again. And now we have what we're about to birth, which is a beautiful thing. So when you're looking at metaphysical healing, the key thing is recognizing that self-care is really at the root of it. It's really at the root of how we can move forward with things. There's a book out right now that's called The Art of Flourishing. And interestingly, it showed up in my life just about 2.5 weeks ago, and then I was looking at an old Science of Mind magazine, and sure enough, it ended up showing up in there as a review, and I didn't even know they would be connected. It was kind of funny, and not. And I noticed that the way that they set the book up, it was very interesting. It's about a psychotherapist who specializes in meditation. So he's taken Eastern philosophy and Western philosophy and put them together, which is very similar to, of course, what we do here in this teaching. But the nucleus of this book and the sort of the inspiration of it was a Zen Buddhist master. And he had been practicing for many, many years, obviously, because he was a master, but he was finding that he hadn't got really to where he needed to be and wanted to be in terms of his own personal development. What his experience was, only speaking for his experience, was that the Zen Buddhism enabled him to move away and get a new idea about what his past had been. He had had a very abusive, difficult childhood, and he had been able, through the practice of Zen Buddhism, to create a new experience. But the trigger was still there. Yes, he had this over here, as long as he didn't look back. Yes, he had all this beauty and all this wonder in his life, as long as he didn't sort of say, what was it that happened in my childhood? So he came to this psychotherapist, and through the combination of the meditation, which he was already working on in the Zen Buddhist practice, and through the combination of that with self-care and self-love, which is a lot of what we do here, that Buddhist master was able to transcend his previous experience and feel more connected with who he is, who he was and is as an individual, and greater connected to that greater consciousness that we know we all are. These are important things because we're always operating between that absolute and that relative. I know Dr. Ken always talks about how we're not really much good to anybody if we just sit on the mountaintop and meditate on our own. Our value comes when we bring that knowledge and we are able to share it within community so that we can grow each of us, each and every one of us, into that greater expression. I know there have been times when I've thought, you know what, I'm just gonna hide. Because when I hide, nothing ever goes wrong, which isn't actually true. But I feel like I can control things a little bit more, right? I'll just go into my little cubby hole and I'll just stay right here, do my thing. Other people can figure out what they're doing. I won't get involved in any of office politics and all that kind of stuff. I just remove myself from all of that and everything will be perfect. But I'm not growing anything. I'm not growing the consciousness of anything. I'm sort of, maybe, kind of, because I do tend to be in that field of communication, but it's still limited. And that's what the beauty is of having this community here, is we get to practice some of those things. It was neat that Sharon mentioned, you know, her own experience of healing. And it was especially profound for me because I just got an email from my mother, who rarely emails. We usually talk on the phone. And she sent it yesterday, the 11th of February. And like Sharon, she had breast cancer and she had a radical mastectomy and she was only 37 when it happened to her. And so I was only 13 at the time. And she was sort of writing to myself and my sister to sort of say how blessed she felt that A, she too was cancer-free after all these years, and that she never expected that she would have the pleasure of being in everyone's company after all this time. That was not on her, you know, there was a time when she just didn't think that was gonna happen. And as I've seen her sort of grow and come to grips with that, because it was a very, you can imagine, it was a very difficult experience for her, her ability to embrace and to share in her own community is immense. It's just immense. I mean, she moved to Nelson from Vancouver about 20 years ago. She can't walk down the street without everybody almost running after her to say hi. I mean, what a great life that must be, right? To be almost 75 years old and people running after you just to say hi. Talk about healing. And it's that way that she gives back to that community and sort of brightens other people's experience in doing that. People love dropping by and doing things for her, and it's really quite a precious thing. So I just wanted to look at one of these other things that I had here, thinking about what the different experiences are like. And I think that when I think mostly about the Center for Spiritual Living and this change that we're going through, it is really profound. And the real value whenever we go through any kind of healing, the real value is to remember to be exactly who we are. To remember to take in the truth of what that is and to make sure that we don't deny that. Because when we deny the truth of who we are, we get these little signals. And I just want to tell you about one of the ones that I had that I never knew I had. It's a little embarrassing, but hopefully you'll bear with me. So I had this, remember I talked about the condition that my friend had? So I had a condition too, but my condition showed up when I was, I think, maybe 4 months old or something like that. And I used to call it my bad toe, because I had a toenail that wasn't very pleasant. And it just showed up when I was, I don't know, 4 months, my mom says, some long time. Anyway, recently, the nail decided that it was time to move on. So it left. And And I was quite anxious about it, right? Like, I don't like talking about it. I don't like anybody knowing about it. So this is really me really coming out there. And you know, for years and years, I only wore certain shoes. You know, it was just like a big thing for me. And I finally go to the doctor and I say, you know, I don't know what to do about this now. You know, I've had it now bandaged up for 3 weeks, right? And I'm doing yoga class and, you know, my toes, I don't, you know, they're on the ground and I don't like that. And it's becoming really awkward for me to try and do my yoga. And there's all these things. And so I said, okay, so I've taken this off. You can take the Band-Aid off, but please, please, please don't touch it. And he says, Karin, it's fine. There's nothing, like, it's healed. There's nothing there. I'm like, really? And he starts moving my toe around and I couldn't feel a thing, like not a thing. And then after realizing that I couldn't feel a thing, I thought, oh yeah, but in a couple of days I'm gonna feel something, right? And nope, not at all. And all of a sudden in the last few days, just the last like 5-6 days, I started to feel this amazing, I know it's just a toenail, but this amazing sense of freedom. For the first time in my life, I am not holding that one toe in a certain form because I don't want it to get hurt. I am no longer oversensitive. I've released it and it's gone. And it just feels so big. And in the process of that, of course, I had to accept myself with all my warts slash weird toe. And so I think that this is, I mean, it's an odd metaphor, but going back to that body and the way it works and the organ and the organization, I think that we can learn from these sorts of things. These are not accidents. Our body shows us how things work, and they work on the inside exactly the same way as they work on the outside. I watch somebody transform in their healing. I don't even have a clue how much more work is going on the inside, right? She had to tell me there was still more work going on the inside. I saw her as perfect, whole, and complete long before she was able to release that and be in that place. It is an amazing process. And when we love ourselves for all of who we are, we get all of that freedom and all of that growth and all of that expansion. And then by doing that, we enable all of us, we give everybody else permission to do exactly the same thing, and we enable all of us to grow that much greater. So I really encourage all of you to take on that, because the only thing that the world really needs is for each and every one of us to be whole. So I thank you. I love you so much. Can't wait to see you again. Namaste.